Our scripture reading this morning is Luke chapter 2, verses 15 through 19, I believe. Yeah, 15 through 19. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they would had been told. Take these off before I walk.
Step off the ditch. Good morning once again, everyone.
Good morning.
So this is the last sermon on unexpected gifts. Just so you know, next week we'll be starting a whole new series in the book of Proverbs. But don't worry, we're not going to be doing all of Proverbs all at once because we'll be there until Jesus comes again. So we're going to do maybe 10 or 12 chapters. We'll go to something else. We'll come back. But I think in times such as today, in the world we live in, some basic wisdom would do us, or at least it would me, do us pretty good. So we're going to look at some of the Proverbs there. But today we're going to continue to talk about Christmas because right now, for most of us in our brains, Christmas is over, right? It's done. It's the 25th has passed. Now it's New Year's mode, if you have a New Year's mode. And after New Year's mode, it's survived to the spring mode, whatever it might be. We kind of get in these modes that we go through. The scripture's clear, especially in verse 19, that after Christmas, Mary did something that's very profound. And I think if we take her up on this activity, we'll be better off. So let's go to the Lord in prayer as we look at this other unexpected gift that God gives us, the gift of memory, remembrance. Let's pray. Father, we come before you and give you thanks for you are here with us to teach us and train us and comfort us. Father, you are here with us because that's the kind of God that you are. You walk with your people. And one day, we will walk with you like you walked in the garden with Adam, face to face, and we will see you as you are. But until then, God, we want to devote ourselves to your revealed words so that we can live lives that are worthy of the calling that you have given us. So, God, we pray that you would open our eyes to these things once again this day, this morning, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let me just read to you verse 19 again, because a lot of people just kind of skip over this, and they kind of look at it and go, oh, that's nice. That's a nice thing. So it says, Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. What does it mean when she treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart? She does something that no one else in the scriptures regarding Christmas, did. She treasured the events. All the stuff that happens with these strange men coming to the downstairs room in probably her family's home and all the miraculous events, she just treasured them and pondered them when everybody else seemingly forgot. Herod, the scribes and the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who knew exactly what was going to happen. What they did was they forgot, in a very short period of time, they forgot Christmas. This is what Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 9 says about this idea of the importance of memory. This is God warning his people Israel. Be careful and watch yourselves closely so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen or let them fade from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to their children after them. By the time Jesus enters ministry, 25, 30 years down the road from this Christmas event, people seem to be totally unaware. Despite what the shepherds did, 30 years since the little town of Bethlehem, 30 years since the Savior had been born to this Jewish virgin where the prophet Micah had prophesied it, and everybody in the royal household knew about it because Herod asked about it, right? They all knew about it. 30 years from today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. 30 years from that great announcement that he would come and save his people from his sin. 30 years, and the Jewish leaders seemed to be ignorant that he was born. Now, Herod wasn't ignorant. Herod tried to kill him at around 2 or 3 years of age. But the wise men came, the magi came. They knew he was going to be a king. The magi, remember, were kingmakers. That's what they did in Parthia, in Persia. They said, this guy's the king. That's the power they had. They come to Israel, to Roman territory, and said, that guy's going to be the king. How could Rome forget? Never mind the Jewish people. Herod knew, where is this king that's going to be born of the Jews? And he told the magi that, and they knew exactly. It was in Bethlehem, in Judea, in this town of David. They knew the scriptures. So, why? Why didn't these knowledgeable scribes and Pharisees join the wise men in their search and rejoice with them that Micah's great prophecy had been fulfilled? And then 30 years, they had 30 years to ponder those events. Why didn't they think about it after the event? Why did they forget God's promises? Why did they forget God's goodness? See, they either forgot or they ignored it altogether. With all of the events that happened at Christmas, why didn't they recognize their long-awaited Messiah and wait earnestly until he grew up? Why didn't they put two to two together between the baby born in the manger and this guy showing up in front of John the Baptist? And he said, this is the Lamb of God taking away the sins of the world. Why didn't they put it together? See, the danger that we all have as human beings is the danger of forgetting or forgetfulness. One of the major problems that human beings have is our short-term memory when it comes to the blessings we have. We take the good for granted and hold on to the bad, tragic, and unpleasant. Recognize that in your life, that the good things that we have, we forget about almost immediately. But the bad things that happen to us, we ruminate on over and over. We think about how bad things are. When it comes to God's people, history shows that they often forgot the movement and miracles of God among them. And because they forgot, they suffered for it. The very act of forgetting what God had done caused suffering and plagued their nation. This kind of goes through a number of things from Judges chapter 8. Remember the book of Judges, God's people sin. A foreign army or a foreign nation comes in, takes them over. They cry out to God, right? Then God comes in, provides them with a judge who rescues them from that oppression. And there's peace for a few years. And then what do? Forget again. And then oppression comes in. So this is one example. Then it came about, as soon as Gideon was dead, one of the great judges, that the sons of Israel again played the harlot with the Baals and made Baal Bereth their god. Thus the sons of Israel did not remember the Lord their God, who had delivered them from the hands of all their enemies on every side. See, this didn't just happen once. The whole book of Judges should be called the book of forgetting. And that's all they did. They forget, they oppress, they cry, oh, now they remember God. Bad things. Oh, cry out to God. And God frees them again because God's a good, good God. And then they worship other gods and they slap God in the face. They rebel and God, they forget. And God goes through over. Throughout the history of the book of Judges, that's what you have. People forgetting the goodness of God. In Deuteronomy, a warning from Moses. It shall come about if you ever forget the Lord your God and go after other gods and serve them and worship them. This happened before Judges, by the way, so this is a warning. They didn't heed. I testify against you today that you will surely perish. Like the nations the Lord makes to, like the nations that the Lord makes to perish before you, so you shall perish because you would not listen to the voice of the Lord your God. If you ever forget the Lord and go after other gods. Passage after passage after passage like this can be found throughout the Bible. God's people forget over and over and over. It was chronic. It happened over and over again. If they have that problem, then probably we do too. We forget. Look at Psalm 106. It says, yet he saved them for his name's sake, to make his mighty power known. He rebuked the Red Sea and dried it up. He led them through the depths as through a desert. He saved them from the hand of the foe, from the hand of the enemy. He redeemed them. The waters covered their adversaries. Not one of them survived. Then they believed his promises and sang his praise. It would be nice if it stopped there. But they soon forgot what he had done and did not wait for his plan to unfold. In those verses, forgetting God and impatience with his timing, I went. When you forget God, you get impatient with his timing. As soon as we forget God, that he is here and that he is Lord, we take things into our own hands. We forget. And so we want to do things on our time. And we do that, and we suddenly screw it up because we've forgotten what he has done, and we don't wait for his plan to unfold. And in so many ways, what tends to plague us in life is linked to this idea of remembering God's goodness, his faithfulness, and his power in our lives. One of the most amazing things I learned when I first moved to Sharon and was a minister there and was talking to the Jewish community, and I was talking to some rabbis at one point, and I was asking them about the Exodus. And they go, oh, we don't believe that really happened. What? I just couldn't believe my ear that some Jews believe that the Exodus never really happened. They go, no, we believe the story. The story defines us, but we don't believe it actually happened, as the Bible says. And like, this is the definitive event of your history. This is what made the nation of Israel. This is kind of, you were dead and dying in Egypt, and God raised you and made you a nation, a powerful nation. You know, we don't, you know. They're like, well, how do you even know you? I asked it, but how do you even know you're Jewish then? Right? I mean, what's the defining moment? They forgot the goodness of God, that he parted the Red Sea, that he destroyed the gods of Egypt, that he made a mockery of Pharaoh's power. He was the only God. He was the true God. They forgot it. Remembering God's presence and faithfulness will set a different tone in your life. When you practice remembering, you will have a different tone in your life, one of contentment rather than bitterness, patience, the idea of waiting on God's plan rather than rebellion, choosing your own way and timing. That's exactly what it is, isn't it? Right? When we choose our own way and our own timing, that's an act of rebellion against God. It's idolatry. We need to recognize that. It's not just a little sin or a little white lie sort of sin. It's sin. It's putting ourselves on the throne of God. This exactly was Israel's problem. They saw God's miracles over and over and over again, then forgot. Because they forgot, they became impatient, they became bitter, they took things in their own hands and screwed up their history, their nation, and even the ramifications down to our time. So the main cause of forgetting, here's the main cause. We forget God because of the busyness and blessings of life. They take too much of our time and energy. Busyness and focusing on the temporal blessings. It's great to thank God for the beauty all around us, as long as you thank God primarily as the originator of all that's beautiful. A lot of times I think unfortunately, the beautiful things of God become idols. Y'all, it's not in your outline, but y'all remember the story of the golden snake in the Old Testament? Remember that story? Israel's rebellious, right? And so God sends snakes to them. The snakes bite the Israelites, and they're dying from snake bites. And so God says, Moses, I want you to make a bronze serpent and put it on a pole. Put the serpent on a pole. And when the people look to the serpent, they will be healed. Okay? The serpent was a symbol. I don't know, kind of a convoluted theology there, but ask me about it later if you're interested. But as they looked towards that serpent representing kind of God's healing, they were healed. Did the bronze ornament have anything to do with anything? Absolutely not. It was God. Right? It was looking towards God. Later on in history, what we find out is, what did Israel do with that serpent? They worshipped it. They made it an idol. The very thing that God gave to them to point to Him, they used as Him. We do the same thing. That's why people worship nature. And people worship possessions and money. Because those things all should point us to God as God's blessings and goodness in our lives. And instead, we take them and make them idols into themselves. This is why we forget. Because we take our eyes off God, we put all of our energy on being busy with something, constantly doing something, a Western world problem, and we focus on blessings of God, and we turn them into something that's really not a blessing. The blessings, we make them into curses. We transform them. This is, God goes on, this is from Deuteronomy as well, Deuteronomy chapter 6. When the Lord your God brings you into the land, a land with large, flourishing cities you did not build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you did not provide, wells you did not dig, and vineyards and olive groves you did not plant, then when you eat and are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Notice God's emphasis here, which you did not. All these things you have, you did not provide them for yourselves. They came from God. The blessings that His people would receive would come from God. The land would come from God. All those things would come from God, not from themselves. They didn't build them. They didn't make them. All came from God. And when we think about it, this is the American story. This is our story. Great and splendid cities. Everything that we need to live on is right down the street 5 miles, right? Malls and stores and restaurants. More than any culture in history has ever had. Who provided those? Ultimately, God did. Right? What about houses full of all good things? I don't know about your house, but my house is filled with all good things, most of which becomes junky things, right? We just have so much stuff. Where ultimately that stuff comes from? It comes from God. Hewn cisterns. You ever think what a blessing it is to be in America, to go into the bathroom there and turn the faucet and actually water comes out? Right? Sort of clean. How clean? Pretty clean water, right? So, you know how many countries don't have clean water? Right? And they turn on the spigot, nothing comes out. Like they go to a puddle and they get poisoned and then need water filters to even survive. Vineyards and olive trees. In America, in our area, we call it Hannafords, right? If you need food, right?
Right.
You can go down to Hannafords, and even if you are on a limited income, you can go down and you can get some macaroni and cheese for 69 cents if you had to, right? And survive on that for the rest of your life. Mm-hmm. I mean, the list can go on and on and on. These things are from God, but how often do we take those things and make them idols unto themselves, as if we've provided it? We have. Deuteronomy 6:12. Watch yourself, lest you forget the Lord. Be careful. Do not forget what the Lord has done for you. So how do you remember? How do we get this practice of not forgetting? One thing and two little things that develop out of it. The first thing is this. We have to develop a discipline of remembering. The fullness of our Christian life really is about discipline. It's to discipline ourselves to read the Word, discipline ourselves to pray, discipline ourselves to memorize, to discipline ourselves to worship. All the things we have about discipline, we have to discipline ourselves. Otherwise, those things fall by the wayside. It's the same thing with memory. You have to discipline yourself. You have to learn to treasure up things that are treasure and discard the things that aren't treasure. So here's a question. How often do you intentionally practice remembering? To sit down and go, okay, a lot of important things happened today. Right? God was active in my life. He promises to be active in my life. What happened today? I believe if we start doing that, then Sunday morning we say, any prayer requests, any praise, we don't get cheap, cheap.
we will begin to say, this is what God done. This is what God did. We forget. I don't doubt that God is doing things in our lives throughout the week. If I think about it, I know he has, right? But we forget because I'm so busy and I have other things to worry about and I forget the goodness of God and to watch myself and don't forget the goodness of God. So how often do you return to your memories with significance, telling stories about them, recounting your testimony to other people? Don't just wait till Sunday. Call someone. Recording God's provision in a journal, in a blog, telling your grandchildren, your children, anybody who will open an ear to you. How often do you practice the discipline of remembering to intentionally go about doing it? The passage, right before God's warning to not forget, the scripture says this, should be very familiar to it. Again, this is from Deuteronomy chapter 6. God says this, "These commandments that I give to you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them to your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates." And through the rest of Deuteronomy, the writer goes on and on and on. Throughout the book of Deuteronomy, Moses makes the memory connection explicit as he teaches them how to make it intentional. How do you remember these things? Well, you proclaim your faith, right? This is chapter 4, verse 9. You observe the Sabbath. You give thanks for the blessings you have in chapter 8. You confess your sins in chapter 9. You celebrate the Passover. You remember that in chapter 16. You tithe in chapter 26. You act with justice and compassion to those who are your servants, who are lowly among you. That's in chapter 15. In chapter 24, you take care of immigrants and orphans. In chapter 24, and the poor. Throughout the book of Deuteronomy, it's really not the book of law. Again, it's the book of memory. Mm-hmm. Remember these. Do these things. So this will remind you of the redemption of God. This will remind you who you are. You won't forget if you do these things. If you intentionally practice these things. In doing these things, it reminded them of their story. So as we recount what God has done for us, we proclaim the redemption story in our lives. That's exactly the importance of memory, to proclaim the redemption story in our lives. And Jesus perfected this idea when he instituted the Lord's Supper. Look at this verse in a new way, considering what I said. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 11, instruction that Jesus gave to Paul. "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." It's important to remember. "In the same way, after supper, took a cup, saying, 'This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood.' Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Notice what the remembrance is. It doesn't say, whenever you do this, you remember the cross. It's not saying that. You remember the redemption story. No, it's you remember me. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord. We talked about it this morning. Sometimes the Lord's Supper can in and of itself become idolatry. Right? Just go through the motions and do the ritual. And we forget the living God that's behind the Lord's Supper. Remembering can be a powerful spiritual discipline. And my encouragement to you is that you hone it to perfection. That you do not forget the Lord's goodness in your life. And remember it and ponder it in your heart. So develop a discipline of memory. Just a few just little tidbits here. So number two, how do you do that? One practical way, we live in the 21st century now.
Frank, what's up, Frank? Use technology. Write that down. Technology.
I'm so forgetful, I put my quiet time in my day timer, my phone, right? So set a recurring calendar on your smartphone. Have it beep at you and say, look up Deuteronomy 6:12. Read Deuteronomy 6:12 right now. Don't forget God. Whatever it is, put little reminders throughout the day where in your busyness, it reminds you to stop being busy. To stop thinking about the blessings you have and remember the Lord behind the blessings that you have. Just a simple, did you remember God today? Just something like that will help you immensely. Your smartphone, many of you will have your grandchildren on it. You have, take your grandchildren off. Put, on my phone right now, I have the word hope. That's the kind of the, I don't hope a lot, so hope. Put a scripture, put something on, so whenever that phone goes on, remember it, okay? It's okay to remember your grandchildren, your dogs, and whatever, that's fine. But don't forget the Lord who is behind those very blessings that you have. Because the Lord can give it, and the Lord can take it away, right? Mm-hmm. I put the F in it, that sounds more familiar for those of you now. So the other thing is journal. If you don't journal, if you haven't done that, today is the day to start. You don't have to get it. You can get a paper journal. You can go online and blog. You can journal online. Journal, pray. If you do blog and journal online, be careful what you post online. That's why I think paper journal, do paper because it's safer. Mm-hmm. You talk about your family and stuff without people getting information. Okay. And then in those journals, those blogs, record God's answer. Right? How often do we pray because something else happens, we're busy over here, and record God's answer. If we don't, we're going to forget the person behind the answered prayers. We'll go, I'm so blessed. I hear that all the time. I'm so blessed. What I want to hear from that is, I'm so blessed because God did this for me. I'm so blessed is saying, it's great to say that, but why are you so blessed? Are you blessed because you got a new job? Are you blessed because you got this or that? Because you got your health? Whatever it might be. Ultimately, those are the blessings that come from the great giver of all those things. God warns us, don't forget. If you forget, then you will not experience the fullness of the blessings that God has for us. Because He, Jesus, is the culmination of all of our hopes and dreams. May we not forget that all God has done for us. We need to treasure up these things like Mary did and ponder them in our hearts, remembering that God is the one who gave it to us. And we'll become, I think, if we do that, more and more amazed at the blessings we have. We won't take the little blessings for granted, because we will know that God, the creator of all things, gave these things to us. And then in turn, we'll look at those things not for our own benefit, but because God gave them to us and God's a giver, we'll look at them and go, wow, I've been blessed. And I can now bless others. That's why in Deuteronomy, why is tithing a remembrance of God? That's exactly why. God has blessed you. You're so enamored with how God has blessed you with so much that you just got to do just like God does. And you got to give. And you got to be generous. And you got to teach your grandchildren, your children, your neighbor, and whoever else you meet. You got to do that to shepherds who went from that manger proclaiming what they had saw. Don't forget. Don't forget the gifts of Christmas. Joy, peace, hope, and memory. Because you will recognize that God is much, much bigger than you ever thought He was. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the gift of memory. God, I remember when I was young, I could remember everything. And now, as I get older, I'm becoming more and more forgetful. So God, it's even more important for me to write things down and become more and more disciplined in this area so I don't forget the goodness of God. And I don't just focus on the troubles of the day and the busyness, the things I got to get done. Even as Paul said, we forget what's behind, the good things and the bad things. We press on towards the goal. We want to press on towards the goal of exalting you in all things that we do. And so God, help us to remember that you are great and you are mighty and you do all things well. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.